The mind is not really your enemy. The mind is your friend. We are going to look at that. Amazing day. We're sitting here in the gloaming of a 95 degree heat today. And the clarity is just, it's sparkling. Because what the spiritual path really is one needs to be able to look at the lies that mind is telling, to see them and recognize, why is the mind telling these lies? And then to forgive the mind for telling these lies, and then give the mind an idea which doesn't require it to tell lies. So the difficulty that we experience is that what we have done is we told the mind to lie to us. We said, mind, we want to be prime creator. And mind says, okay, boss. And from that point on, mind starts lying to spirit. Because what else can mind do when you say, mind, I want to experience being prime creator? All that mind can do is lie about that and say, oh, of course you can be prime creator. Here's the way. I know the way. Here's the way. I'll show you. It's just not quite yet. We're preparing for it. Everything from that point on, when spirit says, mind, I want to experience being prime creator, present that to me, is a lie. Mind has to lie. Has to lie. So the key insight, to get right to it, is that mind is lying. With this idea, it is lying 100%. But the mind is not inherently a liar at all. Just the opposite. It's a totally obedient servant to the ideas that spirit gives mind. It's an obedient spirit. It's an obedient mind, an obedient servant. Totally. And yet, it is lying 100% with this idea of spirit being prime creator. And it lies about itself. And it claims it's not an obedient spirit. And not only that, but it tries to prove that it's not an obedient spirit. Obedient servant. So we have the most difficult time sorting through this confusion. As a matter of fact, if it weren't for the Holy Spirit, we could not sort it out. We could not sort it out. Because the mind has this vast constellation of lies that it is telling us. And the lies are so convincing and so self-reinforcing that spirit is just enthralled by these lies. But the Holy Spirit cannot lie at all. It only tells the truth, because it's a creation, a special creation of the Prime Creator to tell spirit the truth about the situation that spirit is in, with mind lying to it. If it weren't for that, we could never get free of these lies, because we are so bamboozled by these lies of mind. Because the mind is so creative, it's perfectly creative, and it's able to spin endless fabrications and lies and deceptions for us, and we are just absolutely enthralled by it. Whereas the Holy Spirit is not bothered by mind's lies at all. It sees right through them from the very beginning without the slightest problem. So the secret to liberation, to salvation, is to listen to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit knows what is true. Well, knows that the mind is not a liar. It knows that the mind is an obedient servant. It knows that the mind is completely functional. It knows that all spirit has to do is choose a new idea, give a new idea to mind, and everything will be fine, perfectly fine. It knows all of this. It is not confused in the slightest bit. But we as spirit are very, very confused, having been told such a massive amount of lies by mind. And mind never stops these lies. They just continue on. And trying to seek guidance from the mind is a ruinous thing, because the guidance that mind will give is a lie. Now, mind is so tricky in this. Imagine if there were a garden hose and it was attached at a faucet. And imagine if you attached the garden hose, the other end, the outlet end, also attached that to a stationary anchor point. And imagine this garden hose was all twisted and kinked up, completely, severely twisted and kinked up. Now, what if you went to the middle of a garden hose and began stretching out, pulling the kinks and the twisting, pushing that to each end of the hose where it's fixed? So what would happen is the middle of the garden hose would be straight and free of kinks and twists. But towards the end of each of the hose, toward each end, it would be extremely twisted. Okay. So when we ask the mind, help us, please help us. Mind says, of course I can help you, which is a lie. It tells you, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to straighten everything out for you. Another lie. And what it does is it seems to help us by getting that center part of the garden hose straightened out. But all it does is it pushes all the trouble. It's still in the hose. It's still with us. It's an illusion that things have been straightened out. No, they have not at all. So then, even you let go of that straight part, all the kinks come back to the center part, and you realize you haven't made any progress at all. Everything's just as bad as it's ever been. And that's the experience with mind. It keeps telling us it's helping us, it's helping us, it's helping us. And then you look at the world and everything, you say, my gosh, it's as bad as it's ever been, if not worse. And the mind makes us all these promises that we're getting free and the world is getting better and all this stuff, all lies. So one can get to the point where it's possible to look at the mind and see all it's doing is telling lies. That's it. It's not telling the truth at all. It cannot, because we told the mind to lie to us. Here's your job, mind, lie to us. Obedient servant, that's what it's doing. It's lying to us 24/7. Jesus said, a liar and a deceiver and a murderer from the very beginning. Murderer, why? Because it's trying to train us trying to train spirit to die to what spirit is. So that's why we have all this death and destruction, loss, etc. And deceiver has to deceive us about telling us we can be prime creator. Liar, it has to lie to us about the mandate and how we're doing this and it's succeeding, etc., etc. So it's a liar and deceiver from the very beginning. However, this is only the mind's presentation that is this way. It is not the mind itself. The mind itself remains a perfectly obedient and marvelous servant of any idea we give to it. It's just the presentation that the mind is giving us that is so awful. The mistake that we make is saying, mind, can you not please make it a little better? And of course, what does mind do? It lies to us and says, of course I can. Of course, of course. What would you like? That's a lie. It doesn't make it better. It never makes it better. It straightens out the middle of the garden hose. All the tension, all the problems are still there. They're all still present. And boom, you realize, oh my gosh, it's still just as bad, if not worse. So it's amazing to see all the lies that mind tells. You can look at the mind and everything it says to you is a lie. Everything it says to you is a lie. And you just watch it and it responds this way. And you say, oh no, I know that's a lie. It responds another way. That's a lie. This is a lie. This is a lie. So how do you, get free of all those lies? You want to believe something. The mind, you want to say, mind, I want you to be functional. Well, the Holy Spirit says mind is functional. It's the idea you gave mind that is a non-functional idea. It's the idea saying, mind, I want to be prime creator. I don't want to be spirit. I want to be prime creator. We're saying, I don't want to be spirit. I want to be prime creator. It's saying, mind, somehow you have to get me to die to what I am. Because remember, we didn't create ourselves. Prime creator created us. Reality is all one indivisible whole. Therefore, there's no parts that can be cut out of it. So if we want to change what we are, if we want to die to what we are, all of reality would have to die. It would be an annihilation. So we're really saying, and we ask to change what we are, we're asking for annihilation. We're asking for an annihilation. And so mind says, oh, no problem. Yeah, we can do that. We'll train for it. And so here's this mind presents this vast stage, a gymnasium, to work out with all these various teaching aids and training programs to teach us how to die to what we are, to how to be annihilated and then survive it and then be resurrected from it. So this is existence. This is existence. Mind tells us that we're stuck with this, that God made this training program. This training program is for our own benefit, that supposedly we are evolving and we're getting growing, that God wants us to grow, God da 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 da, on and 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 on. A million lies, and then a million more lies, and a million more. And who has the time and patience to continuously vet every single lie like that? It's like counting grains of sand on the beach. So, the Holy Spirit is the answer. It is able to show us that these lies are all, the similarity of all these lies, where they're coming from, why they're arising, and what the remedy is. And gradually you're able to see through the whole pattern of mind's lying without worrying about every last single one. It's all a lie. It has to be a lie. And you begin to catch it very quickly and see through it all. Without the Holy Spirit, you will just feel like it's impossible, and you'll give up. You'll give up, and you'll settle for one of the mind's lies. You'll settle for one of the lies. Mind says, "Oh, when the body dies, you're free. You're saved." A lie. You know. Is there any lie that mind won't tell? The answer is no. It will tell any and all lies, whatever works, to keep us believing in this training program. Keep us believing in this training program. And it just delays us, it delays us, it delays us. All these lies are just delay. All it is delay. That's all that my mind can do, is just keep us hooked on this training program that will never succeed. And it's really so horrible for us, and we feel so terrible. The mind just tells us all these lies about it. Oh, it'll be worthwhile in the end. You know, hey, if you just see it through, you'll be fine. If you just persevere with this, everything's going to work out for you. And everything's for the best, and there's this vast plan that everything's working out for you, and all lies, all of it. What you need to do is to choose a new idea. You need to say, "Mind, here's the new idea, and prepare me for timelessness." And then mind will be a faithful servant to that idea, preparing us for timelessness. That's all that we can do. That's what the Holy Spirit has shown me. That's all that we can do. That's it. There's nothing more. We can't straighten out the lies of mind. It will keep lying. That's a lie itself. The idea that we can straighten out the lies of mind is also a lie. We need mind to be a faithful servant and give us what we want. It already is that way. So it already is faithful. It is giving us what we want because we asked to be prime creator. Now, it's impossible, but it's giving us a simulation, simulating a way that, and telling us there is a way, and of course there isn't. But what else can mind do? Mind can't say, "Spirit, I can't do this." Then we'd say, "Oh, you're disobedient, huh?" No, mind has to say, "Of course, there's a way. There is a way." And then that's a lie. And then the lies continue and continue and continue. On and on and on, saying, "Oh, of course, there's a way. Here's the way." And we say, "Wait a minute, this isn't working." And mind say, "Well, you know, you just have to hang in there. It's going to work for you eventually." Nonsense. Will never, never work. We can never become prime creator. It will never work. So it doesn't matter how we train at all. It doesn't matter. So the capacity to see through the mind's lies is wonderful. Now, here's the trouble, is that mind tells us that if we look at these lies, we'll go crazy, we'll be annihilated, we'll die. It tells us all, it tries to terrify us into not looking at its lies, not seeing them, not looking there. It tells us, if you, it's a taboo. If you look at that, you will be annihilated or something. Again, all lies, all lies. It says, if you see that lie, that I'm nothing but a liar, I'm telling you, just all lies, you will lose all faith in me, and you will fall into terrible depression. That's a lie, too. That is another lie. You see how its lies are just nonstop? Because it's opposite. The most joyful time you have in this scenario is seeing the lies of mine and saying, oh my gosh, thank God I saw that lie. I've been trapped by that lie for so long, and you're happy. You say, oh, that's wonderful relief, thank you very much, I finally saw that. This is what's been keeping me bound to misery for so long. You're not depressed. You feel like celebrating, this is terrific. Finally, I've seen through that lie. So again, mind telling us that we'll be suffering horrible. Not true, just the opposite. So mind cows us into not looking. Satsang means looking. Inquiry means looking. Looking at the lies of mind and seeing them, that they're lies. And then again, you're happy to see that. You're really happy because you say, oh, I can't be fooled again by that lie. It's diminished. The power over me is diminished about that lie. Saying that I have to keep suffering forever. Now I see that's a lie. So how can we not be happy about that? We're not depressed over that. The only way we get depressed is if we believe another lie, saying what the mind says. You see, that proves I'm a disobedient servant, or you can't trust me. Another lie. It says, say, no, mind, you're a totally obedient servant, because I told you to lie to me. And now I see you've been very obedient to that. So just say, hey, thank you, mind, I told you to lie to me, and that's what all you've done. Now I'm going to tell you to tell me the truth, and you're going to do that just as obediently. The one thing the mind cannot do is tell you both lies and truth. It cannot be faithful to both lies and truth, because each one denies the other. So let's put it this way. You can ask mind to do that, but what you're going to experience is instant, total chaos, mental chaos. And I experienced that, and you can only have that experience for just one moment, and it can't be sustained at all. No way to sustain it. So I literally experienced that. The mind can't, you can say, show me both truth and lies. I want you to both lie to me and tell me the truth. And what happens there is mind presents this complete chaos, so you cannot tell whether it's a lie or truth. There's no way to tell. It's as if the mind is in a complete state of chaos, and you say, ah, no, mind, you cannot be that way. And then so, because it has to symbolize this canceling out activity, because to lie and tell the truth both at the same time would be this canceling out, as it were, as if the mind were presenting nothing. And so the way to present this, since mind cannot cancel itself out, is this complete mental chaos symbolized by just motion, this like a sense of chaotic motion everywhere, just totally chaotic motion everywhere. And that is a terrible experience. So then we say, well, I have to go back to either you're telling lies or you're telling the truth about reality. See, you cannot tell half-truths about reality. Either what you say about reality is true or it's not true. So there's no such thing of, you can't say, mind, tell me partial truth, because that is a lie. There's no such thing as partial truth. No such thing as partial truth. And so we weed through this on the spiritual path. It's so tiresome to be struggling with the mind in this way. We want to give up the struggle with the mind, and we want to simply give the mind a new idea. Say, here you go, mind. This is yours now. This is prepare me for timelessness, to step into timelessness. You see, give the mind that idea to present. Stop the struggle with the mind. The struggle with the mind can go on forever. If you try to do that, it will go on forever. Now, one of the ways that some people try is they try to say, well, there's nobody to ask mind for anything, so it doesn't matter what the mind presents. the mind says, that's it. That's another lie. The mind says, yeah, you can be safe for me. Just don't have anybody who even cares what I'm presenting. So I can present lies and it doesn't matter. that's not what we're looking for. Because that's not reality functions. It's not like, oh, everything's fine. All existence, everything, it's just great. No, it's a prepping for annihilation. This is not the kind of stuff. That's not fine with us. We don't want that. So how do we get something different? Not by just saying there is no I, there is no self, there is no one to choose. There isn't. It's just that doesn't solve the issue at all. It might give us some sort of undisturbedness, feeling relatively undisturbed, because we just say, well, there's nobody to be disturbed. But who are we kidding? Who are we kidding? Spirit is created to function in with the way reality is, to choose experiencing of the most incredibly deep and rich type of experiencing, and to flow with all that. And you can't, was not created to say, well, there is no spirit, so it doesn't matter whether that we have this terrible cruddy backwater training program here, and this awful impermanence and disaster and death and everything, and it just, well, it's okay, but there's nobody to experience that, so it's all okay. I'm just aware of it, but there's no experiencer of it, really. Mind tells us that that is the answer. That's a lie. That's another lie. That is another lie. And for a while, that's like straightening out the kinks of a garden hose in the middle. For a while, people think, oh yeah, I'm undisturbed. You know, I don't feel very disturbed. Whatever happens is not affecting me, because there is no me to be affected. There's nothing to be affected. I'm just pure awareness, and everything's just arising, and it doesn't matter what arises or doesn't arise and all this kind of stuff. That's not how I understand enlightenment or salvation at all. That's not what the Holy Spirit has shown me. What I've been seeing is that you give mind a new idea, and you then experience this incredible bliss and richness and calm, and the world is transformed, and it seems utterly sublime and beautiful, and your mind is making this incredibly beautiful presentation to you. It's just amazing. And you're experiencing, you're aware and entirely aware that you are the experiencer, and their mind is presenting this experience. And this is, so I say, choose the idea of prepping for timelessness. And there's a vibrant certainty to it. There's a very, very, very sublime vibrancy of certitude. And it's very, 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 very profound. So I would say, remember, the mind is an incredible liar, and it lies to us about enlightenment, it lies to us about salvation, it lies to us about all of that. It tells us, yes, this is it, that's a lie, you know, as far as just no experiencer, and that's the answer. It's not the answer. So really, we have to be very keen on the mind and its lying, and we have to get the help of the Holy Spirit. And this is one thing I've noticed, is a lot of those who have claimed that they're enlightened, they never talk about the Holy Spirit, or rarely. And the Holy Spirit's all important, because it's the Holy Spirit is the only one, other than the Prime Creator, that knows what is salvation actually, what is really salvation. The mind doesn't know. Spirit's confused. It doesn't know at this point. The Holy Spirit knows. So the clarification we get from the Holy Spirit is a whole different thing than simply asking the mind, and the mind telling us that what's enlightenment, and doing that, and the mind can make it seem like it's enlightenment, because it seems to be a relative absence of disturbance, but it's not freedom. It's not liberation. It's not. Liberation is giving the mind a new idea, exchanging one idea for another, saying, mind, you're going to set down the idea of prepping me for teaching me how to teach me to die to what I am, and you're going to teach me how to live to what I am, to be truly living to what I am, prepping for timelessness. That is what you're going to do, mind. That is true salvation. So it's a very different presentation than what most people are used to here. What I see is the mind is still in control of the world. People are still following the mind, even though the mind's claiming, oh no, you're getting rid of the mind. When you're saying that you're getting rid of the mind, That's a lie. Obviously a lie, because God created the mind. You can't get rid of anything that God created. You're not getting rid of the mind. It's impossible. Just as impossible as getting rid of the spirit. So, oh, I transcended the mind. Again, utterly ridiculous. The mind is an integral part of reality and its functioning. It is the creative part that presents the ideas to spirit. You can't get rid of the mind. You can't transcend the mind. All of that is lies that mind is telling. When lies, the mind tells us we can transcend the mind, it's lying. It's presenting a lie to us. When mind says we can go beyond the mind, that's a lie too. That's like saying we can go beyond reality. We cannot. So, just noticing this is the spiritual path. Noticing all this is the spiritual path. And then realizing, hey, all I got to do is give mind a different idea. Very simple. Way simpler than I thought. But again, mind is presenting us like the perfect lie, the perfect set of lies. So even when people are struggling for salvation, the mind will lie to them about that nonstop. About, oh yeah, this is going to happen, or this will happen, blah, 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 blah. And this is light enlightenment, or this is enlightenment, or this and this. And it goes on and on forever. This presentation never stops lying. The only way the lying stops is to give the mind a new idea. And say, set down the idea of, I want to be prime creator, and trying to prep me to learn how to die to what I am. And here's the idea of prepping me for timelessness so I can know that I live in what I am. That's the way. It's the only way that lies ever stop. The only way that lies ever stop. Otherwise, we will still just be following the lies of mind, the guidance of mind, even when it comes to salvation, even when it comes to enlightenment, liberation, all of that too. Mind will be lying about that and temporarily seeming to enable a certain mental state, as it were, that seems like, ah, this is so much better, you know, but it won't ultimately last at all. All the problems will come back and say, oh my God, I'm still stuck. The safe way is to listen to the Holy Spirit. It may seem like it takes longer because there are lies that you have to see through. You have to see through all these lies of salvation that mind is telling us. You have to see through those. So it seems like the quick path is just to accept what the mind tells us. Say, oh yeah, there's a way to transcend the mind. I can be free of all this. There is no me. There is no self. There is no I. There is no experiencer. Nothing matters. Whatever arises is okay. It doesn't matter. And it seems, well, that's the quick way. That's the quick way. But it's not it's the lie. You're still following the lie of mind with that. So it's not quick at all. It just wastes time. The fast way is to actually listen to the Holy Spirit, get the clarification, see through the mind's lies, and recognize, all of this is a lie, and recognize there's only one remedy for this. Only one. Only one. Only one remedy, which is to give mind another idea, a new idea. Choose a new idea. Choose again, make the exchange. You're no longer prepping for time, you're now prepping for timelessness. You've given mind that idea. Say, mind, this is now your new obedience, a new idea to be obedient to. The mind tells us that it's broken and we need to fix it. That's a lie. Mind says it's sick, needs help. That's a lie. And of course the mind will throw all these mental states that seem all sick and disordered, etc. But that's just part of its presentation. Just part of its presentation. Say, thank you, mind, I see. This is just part of your presentation. All these troubles. And the mind will say, oh, you're sick. How can you possibly be telling me what to do? The mind will try to lie about spirit and then use these bodies as if they were spirit, and then have these bodies do all sorts of things. And the mind will say, oh, look how sick you are, spirit. How can you possibly tell me what to do? That's a lie too. Spirit's not sick. The body is not what we are. All of these things are lies. The mind gets us to follow the lies of the mind, and then claims that in the following of these lies that somehow we've become corrupted. And that's another lie. So you can go on and on and on and just look at these lies and just let them, you know, just everything, bring it up and say, oh, that's a lie. This is another lie. This is another lie. And you just go like that and you say, how wonderful, I'm seeing all these lies that mind is presenting. And don't panic, don't freak out and say, oh my gosh, the mind is a liar. No. We ask mind to give us a lying presentation that we can become prime creator. That's a lie. We cannot. And yet our pride tells us, oh, we want to believe we can. So mind has no choice but to lie to us. So that is the path I've experienced, is seeing through the lies of mind and recognizing them and saying, oh, wait a minute. So it's taken a long time, because the problem is, in the world, you have all these people claiming they're enlightened and they did it fast. They said, oh, here's an easy way to do it. And you think, wow, must be something wrong with me. And you say, listen to them, and you say, oh. And then you listen to the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit says, no. And you say, well, wait a minute, Holy Spirit. I mean, it seems like they're enlightened, and I could get it easily. And the Holy Spirit says, no, that's not the way. And then you're confused. You're confused. And you tend to listen to mind and say, mind, how are you doing this? And mind says, oh, I'll tell you how to do it. It's easy. And then you have to go back to the Holy Spirit and say, and check. And you're really kind of confused and don't know who to trust. And it seems very, very difficult. The teachers I've gone to see, none of them were enlightened. They thought they were, but they weren't at all. It's completely obvious they weren't enlightened. But the mind was telling them that they were enlightened. The mind was telling them that they had transcended the mind. The mind was telling them that there was no I, that there was no I, there was no experiencer, there was no self. The mind was telling them that they were experiencing pure awareness. The mind was telling them all these things. So, and they were believing it, but they certainly weren't enlightened. It's obvious, because when you see one who's truly liberated, then you know, and then you know there's such a huge difference. You say, wow, how do you account for this huge difference? Because they're really just believing what mind is telling them. Mind will happily tell you that you've transcended the mind, or the mind has been slain, or you've gotten rid of the ego, or you've gotten rid of the I, you've gotten rid of there is no I. Mind will tell you whatever you want to hear. It'll tell you, yes, you're finally free. Or there is no one to be free. You're free because there is no one to be free, as it were. Mind will tell you all those things, and it will put a spin on them, because these things are a takeoff. They're a distortion of what is true. Actually, they're a distortion. There is no psyche per se. The psyche is not a set identity, so there is no actual identity in the psyche, but there is an identity in spirit, and this identity is experiencing this play. It is experiencing it. It's just not the psyche that's experiencing it. So there is an experiencer. It's just not the psyche. So, and the experiencer and the experienced are one. So there are some who seem to be in this enlightened mode, more or less, and there's a lot that are not. So it's very confusing, and that's the point of mind is mind is this perfect liar. You know, mind is, this presentation is a perfect lying. That's what you expect from mind. It's the perfect servant, perfectly creative, so it will just lie unbelievably well to us. So we shouldn't blame ourselves for falling for these lies. Of course we're going to fall for them. That's what we ask mind to do, is get us to fall for a pack of lies. The entire deck of cards that mind has is all lies. No matter what card the mind is dealing, it's a lie. Period. In this presentation, because we asked it to lie to us. So, listen to the Holy Spirit and get to the point you see, all I have to do is give the mind a different idea, and it will be obedient to that idea. Then, in that context, then everything is exactly right. And of course, the mind can say all sorts of things about that. Also, those who are still having the mind lie to them, the mind will tell them all sorts of things about that condition you're in, and lie to them about that, of course. And say, oh, here's how you get it, or here's how you do it, or whatever. So it's difficult for anyone who's enlightened in this world to present this to the world, because everybody will only listen to what the mind says about it. Almost everyone. they'll say, okay, now what's that? And mind will whisper to them, say, this is what it is. And they'll say, oh, wow. And mind will tell them some great, very clever lies about it, and then they'll believe that. So ultimately, the only answer is the Holy Spirit, the only answer for everybody. Each and every one has to learn to listen to the Holy Spirit, to pay attention to the Holy Spirit, and continue to do so, so that they eventually can see for themselves to give the mind a new idea, that is the remedy. It's not somebody else's enlightenment that's the remedy. It's giving the mind a new idea that's the remedy. So don't worry about figuring out someone else's enlightenment. Just keep asking the Holy Spirit, what is the answer for me? What is the answer for me? It's the same for everybody, but ask it for yourself. Say, what is the answer for me? And the Holy Spirit will say, eventually guide you to make the exchange of ideas, choose a new idea, give the mind a new idea so it can present that idea to you. It will maneuver you towards that clarity somehow. You don't have to figure out anybody else. The answer is the same for everyone. So don't worry about too much about what anyone else is doing, what they're claiming, all this and this and that. If there's something helpful for you, the Holy Spirit will find it for you. But still, it's for you. It is for you. It is for your salvation. And you need to work it through with the Holy Spirit. There's no other remedy, because only the Holy Spirit is perfectly clear and incapable of believing in any lies. Telling lies cannot tell any lies, cannot believe in any lies, cannot. Whereas we, Spirit, we can definitely believe in lies. when we ask the mind to present this idea of becoming prime creator, we are basically saying we're going to believe in a lie. That's what. But the Holy Spirit, again, a special creation of God, cannot believe in lies. Cannot. It can only bless reality, bless truth. It can never believe in lies. It only knows truth. Period. So it's different. The Holy Spirit is a little bit different than Spirit. And that Spirit can believe in lies if it wants to. The Holy Spirit cannot. So it's completely trustworthy. The Holy Spirit is entirely trustworthy. Whereas Spirit and mind, no, Spirit and mind can get lost in lies. I mean, Spirit can get lost in the lies of mind. Absolutely so lost, completely lost. It has no clue what it is, where it is, what reality is. Nothing. Completely lost. But it's not lost completely, because the Holy Spirit is with Spirit. And clarifying for Spirit and whispering to Spirit, saying, hey, don't trust the lies of mind. This is what you did. And explaining to us. Well, what we did, why have we been in this confusion? So we are not entirely lost, because the Holy Spirit is with us. The Holy Spirit can be very subtle. I guess it works with everyone differently, but for me it is very subtle. Very creative, very subtle. It's so subtle you don't even, can hardly be aware that's even working on your behalf at all. And you'll realize something. You say, how did I get that? That's amazing. How did I do that? And you don't even know how you managed to do it. And you say, well, I remember, but there's some kind of, I feel some sort of orchestration, but it's so incredible and subtle. Ah, it can't be possible. How's that possible? That's the Holy Spirit. That's the Holy Spirit. In other words, how did I get to the point of being able to say what I'm saying here? It's the Holy Spirit. Because most people say it's just impossible to say these things, to say the mind and say this in this way about the mind, so simple and so obvious and so to the point, etc. They say, no way. How's that possible? And it's the Holy Spirit somehow orchestrated it all. You can't point to any one thing. The orchestration is, again, total genius, total creativity, total fidelity to truth, and therefore it's not explainable in words how the Holy Spirit can do it at all, because it's completely flawless in what it does, whereas words are just, you know, very ambiguous and ragged and uncertain and easily twisted and confused and misunderstood, etc. The Holy Spirit doesn't have to deal with that at all. It can show you directly. It somehow is able to get your attention to look where you need to look. To look past the taboo when the mind says, if you look there, you'll be annihilated. The Holy Spirit says, no, you won't. No, you won't. And somehow it gets you the courage and you can see, oh, I can do that. And you look, And then you see it and say, aha. But that's okay. That's okay. It's a hot summer evening. That's part of the excitement. A lot of bugs flying around. So when you say, well, trust in the Holy Spirit, you say, well, where's the Holy Spirit? I don't see it. How come it's not talking to me? I don't hear it. You know, how can I trust in something that's invisible and I'm not even aware of its presence? It doesn't intrude upon us. It's not intrusive. I can say, honestly say, the Holy Spirit has never been intrusive with me. Never, not even once has it ever been intrusive. It always is like invisible. And it just leaves the faintest footprints. Just for a fleeting moment, a faint footprint, you might say, so it's never intrusive. Holy Spirit is never intrusive. So if you think, oh my gosh, I don't want my life to be intruded upon, that's fine. It will not intrude upon your life, but it will enable you to see what you haven't seen before. What I mean by that is to look in places where you haven't looked before. Put your attention in places you haven't put it before. That's what's important. And the mind will say, well, I can do that too. I can tell you where to put your attention in different places. Well, of course it can, but it's not the same. You know it's not the same. Because the mind will say, well, look at this, how about that? And you say, yeah, I haven't seen that before, but the Holy Spirit will orchestrate something. Well, you see, oh my gosh, the mind has been lying to me all this time about this, and I see it very clearly. Different story, right? Different story. And the mind will even point out its own lies, but only to set up some other lies. You know, say, oh, I've been lying over here, but now you see it, and I'm not doing it anymore or something. But it still is. So the Holy Spirit, again, its objective is to get you to give mind a new idea. It's not merely to point out the lies. It has something objective beyond that, whereas the mind will just claim, oh, no, I'm pointing out my lies to you. I can be truthful to you. That's a lie. It's pointing out, it might point out some lies to preserve the others, so that when the mind tells you, don't look here, you'll say, huh, the mind has been truthful to me saying that these lies, so I must trust it here, I must trust it, and then you don't look there, and you remain bound by those lies where the mind says, don't look there. So you see how clever the mind is. So clever. And you wonder, oh, how in the world can I get past that cleverness? Well, give the mind a new idea. The idea of a prepare me for the step into timelessness, the step into reality. Prepare me for that. Prepare me to accept that I abide in myself for all eternity. And mind will then present that to us. And we don't have to worry about the lies of mind. Or we don't have to catalog them. We don't have to do anything about them. Gone. They're gone. And they're not arising anymore. Because what arises is continuously arising. And if it's no longer arising, if a lie no longer arises, it's there's nothing to it. You see? So it's not like it's somewhere, but it's gone. It went somewhere. No, it just stops arising like a fountain. The fountain is arising, and you turn off the electricity of the fountain, and the pump stops, and the water just falls back into the pool, and the water's still there. Water didn't disappear. It's just no longer being shot up as a fountain. Still there. So mind and spirit are still there. It's just the mind is no longer telling lies. It's fanciful tales. Tomorrow's going to be hot too. Very hot. It hit, Sacramento's like 105 today. Hitting hundreds everywhere. Crunching it. What is it today? Today's the 7th, June 7th. Well, it's time. Time for the heat to be turned up. The heat in the world is being turned up. Mind is presenting just a whopper of a mess in the world. Just a mess. And telling lies right and left. It is really... It's a play that is hard not to watch. I'm trying not to watch it because it is so, the actors are so good. They're really good. The actors on stage now are really top-notch actors. They're just marionettes, of course. They're just puppets. They're just believers in mind, and mind's pulling their strings. But oh my gosh, they're good actors. you know, the audience is watching saying, hey, you're lying. And the actor says, oh, no, everything's fine. Everything's under control. There's no lie here. Nothing to see here. Move on. And we say, wow, it's done so well. I almost feel like believing you, you know. it's like we almost believe people in the world. We almost believe, like, what they're saying, oh, there's no problems. Don't worry. We almost believe it and say, wow, what an incredible actor. What an incredible liar they are. We have some really incredible liars in the world right now. And a lot of people believing them. It's like saying, they don't believe them entirely. They know they're lying, but they're saying they like the incredible chutzpah, you know, of these liars. And they say, the people who like it are saying, gosh, I wish I could lie like that. I wish mine could teach me how to lie like that. You know, that's like really incredible. So they like it. They say, yeah, they cheer and say, of course, that's wonderful. They know they're lying, of course. But they enjoy the acumen, they enjoy the show, they enjoy the bravura performance. It's a virtuoso performance that's taking place in the world. Virtuoso performance of this incredible lying that's taking place. And then when you see it, they say, oh, those who are seeing it, like, really? Oh, you guys really lack an education. I mean, if you had an education, you wouldn't be fooled in that way. You wouldn't see it as a lie. You'd see it's true. You know, the lies are true, and truth is our lies. The mind is saying that, basically. What the mind is saying now is that lies are true. And we're all saying, oh my gosh, this is so amazing. It's so convincing. How wonderful. The actors are wonderful. They're telling us the lies are true. And we're all like, you know, so many are like embracing this and saying, oh gosh, the lies are true. Isn't that a wonderful concept? Of course, that's what we want to hear, because we want to believe that we can be prime creator, which is a lie. And if we say, well, lies are true, then we think, oh, we can be prime creator because lies are true. So we're getting all these lies coming from us, trickling down from the higher ups, who are just very adept liars. And we're applauding it, saying, oh, finally, someone is confirming that lies are not, our lies are true. No worries, folks, lies are true, and you'll soon see it. And the rest of us are saying, wow, you know, wow, it's getting worse and worse, the lies are getting worse and worse, and they're doubling down, and gosh, these things are getting more terrible. And the rest of people are saying, oh no, lies are almost true, they're almost true, so we're going to have a wonderful, you know, the breakthrough is going to be great, it's going to be terrific, golden age is here, lies will be true. Yeah, so we have this very funny drama going on between those who are, you know, cheering and those who are booing and hissing. There's like this hubbub going on. It's like some of the baseball games where the San Francisco Giants will go on the road like to San Diego, and there's so many Giants fans down there that like half of the fans are Giants fans at those games. The other half are San Diego Padre fans. And so when someone hits a home run or something, there'll be this uproar. Because half the fans are like cheering, the other half the fans are booing. And it's like this incredible hubbub, you know, and it's like, wow, what's going on? What's going on? It's like when the Yankees or the Red Sox travel too. You know, the Yankees will come to Oakland and there'll be half the fans will be Yankee fans, and then there'll just be this enormous hubbub the whole game. It's quite amazing. Quite amazing. And that's what the world is like now. You got half the people cheering and half the people booing. And hissing and yelling and screaming, and it's just this hubbub is just going on. And there's a tendency to like say, oh, you know, what's the hubbub? What is this really sudden hubbub? This is very interesting. What's going on? Like that. And yet we know what's going on. What's going on is that, of course, spirit wants lies to be true. And what we're getting a super virtuoso performance now of telling us that lies are true. And then you get others who say, no, whoa, wait a minute, I'm not feeling it. Something tells me, my spirit says, this isn't it. And I say, wait a minute. So they say, no, wait a minute, no, this is just, these are lies. And the other people say, that's okay, because lies are true. I say, wait a minute, and now, so you get this dichotomy that's going on. You get the people who at least recognize that, you know what, I don't think lies are going to be true, or what you get also dichotomy of those who think they have a better lie You know, that no, not this. They have a better presenter of lies. I said, no, not this liar is true. There's some other liar that's true, that's even more true. That they, you know, they're the ones. This one, he's an imposter. They're an imposter. These ones are telling lies. They're imposters. I have a better set of lies. Someone, you know. So there's fights over that. Say, no, we like this. This other band, you know, this band, one band's on the stage playing the song, and then another band comes on. They say, I like this band better. So there's all this commotion. You know, I like the way that Conway Twitty sings the song. No, I like George Jones' song version. No, I like Waylon Jennings sang that. No, yeah, Roger Miller. Ah, into the all these different fights, like on the internet. Say, no, this version is better of this song. No, somebody else did it better. Like that. So you have this conflict of a lot of people saying, you know what? This set of lies we're getting now, that's the best set ever. And other people saying, no, we had a better set of lies way, way back when. We had a much, much better set of lies. And this stuff is amateurish lies, you know. We have way superior set of lies to believe in. And you have that conflict too. So it's amazing. But it's, you know, laughter is uneasy laughter, really, because what liars do, what the mind does, it doubles down. What else can it do? So when you're just pushing a set of lies, and you get called on it, and you realize, oh, people realize these are all lies, what do? You lie twice as hard, twice as much. So to confuse people and bamboozle them so much that they say, oh, I'm so confused now that maybe those other lies were true. And so, yeah, I'm okay, everything's okay. Either that or the lies, the jig's up, but mind cannot admit that it's lying except to hide some other lies, you know. It's so confusing. The play of mind is so confusing. It just plays you for a fool, and you just feel like you don't know what to think. You say, my God, it's just horrible. It's really horrible. It's really horrible. You just can't get clarity, you can't get peace of mind, you just cannot figure out where the lies, what's the truth and what's the lies. The mind is saying that now this and this and this and this and this, and some lies, some of the lies are true, some are not true, and which ones, and how to judge this and this and that. And just spinning around in circles, just wandering around aimlessly, just lost in a fog, in a haze of confusion. It's awful. So the Holy Spirit, the remedy, tells it's very simple. Just give the mind a different idea. Game over. Checkmate. Checkmate. That's it. See, the mind will have us playing this chess game with it of check, 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 but it always maneuvers out of it. It's like a multidimensional chessboard the mind is playing with. And it always manages to suck you into saying check, and then the mind makes a move like this, and oh, uh-oh, you know, you get tagged, you lose your rook, or you lose your queen, or something, you know, and you thought, oh, I was almost got it, I got it checked, and then, trouble. So what Holy Spirit tells you is to, how to play for checkmate. That's it, it's over, checkmate. Don't play for check, play for checkmate. And that's no play at all, you just simply give mind a new idea. See, mind wants you to keep you playing with this chess game. Why don't you keep you playing? How does it keep you playing? By making you think you're winning. If you feel like you're really losing really badly, you might be saying, man, I'm overmatched here. You know, this is too tough. I can't win. That's why Jesus said, blessed are the poor in spirit. They shall see, you know, see the kingdom of heaven. Because the ones that they're really losing, they say, oh my God, I can't win. This is terrible. Then they listen to the Holy Spirit, and they say, you know, Holy Spirit, I need a checkmate. The mind is too slippery for me. I need a checkmate. And the Holy Spirit will say, great, this is how you give checkmate to the mind here. Whereas those who think they're winning, the mind is making them think that. It's deceiving them. The mind is playing weak, you know, like a chess game. It's luring you into a trap. I say, oh, look at this position. You can really get me here, and you can really get me here, and I'm getting weaker, I'm losing, oh. And it lulls you into it, and then pounces on you. So to think that you're winning against the mind is delusion. Utter delusion. You cannot win. You cannot win against the mind. You can only give checkmate by giving the mind a new idea. In other words, you cannot, that this sense that you're winning, the game against the mind. You cannot win this game against the mind. Checkmate is not so much a winning of the game, it's an ending of the game by giving mind a new game, so to speak. That's how you win the game. That's the only way you win the game. But mind keeps telling you, no, check, you check me, that's a win. You check me, that's a win. Look how he's win, you're win, 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 win. You know, who's that actor saying? Winning, you know. You look at him, you know, the winning thing, and he's a complete loser, you know, terrible loser. Not complete, because the mind keeps giving him a little bit of tidbits of this and that. You know, winning, no, losing, you know, losing. The mind's twisting things around, saying that losing is winning. You know, truth is, lies are true, and losing is winning. And so, checkmate is the way to do it. What's that bug? Wow, there's a bug buzzing. Whoa, what is that? That's a big one. Okay, take it easy, bug. Take it easy. What is that? That's a cricket. Hello, cricket. A little grasshopper. That's a grasshopper. It's a grasshopper. Hello, grasshopper. What are we in the kung fu? Grasshopper, you have finally learned the truth. You have finally realized that you cannot snatch the pebble from my hand. You don't need to. you cut off my hand, so to speak. Or you simply say, I don't need to snatch the pebble from your hand. You know, this whole kung fu thing, like, when you snatch the pebble from my hand, then you are the master. And you say, hey, I don't need to snatch the pebble from your hand. And that's when the master says, ah, now you finally got it. Now you finally got it. You just need to give a new idea to mind. Okay? So, yeah, this grasshopper brings us back to the kung fu series. And that's the answer. See, all the while, the disciple is trying to get faster and quicker and sneak up on the master and get that pebble, you know. When the master isn't looking, I'm going to get that pebble from his hand. But finally, he realizes, hey, why do I need to get the pebble from the master's hand? I don't need to get any pebble from the master's hand. What do I need that for? I don't need that at all. So, I just give the mind a different idea. Here, bless. That's a God bless. See, that's the real teaching. The resolution to the Zen koans is you say, I don't need to resolve this stupid koan. That's the resolution, folks. You see what I'm saying? That's checkmate. That's checkmate. So what is the sound of one hand clapping? You know, what is the sound of one hand clapping? It's not that, you know, it's not that. I solved it. That's the sound of one hand clapping or whatever. What is it? I keep thinking, how is one hand sound that's clapping, etc.? And the answer is, you say, I don't need to answer that question. That's the answer. I don't need to answer it. The mind will say, oh, yes, you do. You can't be the master unless you answer the question. Say, well, I don't need to be the master. I already am the master. Why does the master need to become the master? I just need to say, I am the master of the mind, because I am the one who tells the mind what to do. What idea? And here, I'm going to give the mind a different idea. There's the proof right there. I don't have to answer any koans. I don't have to be enlightened. I don't need to snatch the rock from the master's hand. And I say, well, but if you do that, you'll never be enlightened. So I don't need to be enlightened. What do I need to be enlightened? To who? To the mind? No, the mind already is my obedient servant. I don't need the mind to see me as enlightened. You know, that's another game. That's the lie of the mind. The mind says, well, I need to see you as enlightened. I need you to be the master, spiritual master. I don't recognize you, you know, how you are right now. I don't care what you say you see me as. It doesn't matter what you think, what you're telling me you see me as. Mine makes no difference. I can be a prince or I can be a pauper. It doesn't make no difference. I'm the master and you're the servant. And that's how God created it, and that's how it is. And here's a new idea for you. You don't have to prove anything to the mind. The mind tells you need to prove something to it. that you're really a spiritual master. You've evolved. You've gotten enlightened. You got wisdom. All this nonsense. You don't have to prove anything to the mind. You don't have to prove wisdom to the mind. You don't have to prove enlightenment. You don't have to prove competence. You don't have to prove anything to the mind. God created reality. The mind didn't create reality. You don't have to, who do you have to prove anything to? God knows what reality is. Reality is still real. There always will be. Where is there a need for proof? There's no need for proof anyway. The master, keep the rock. I'm not interested in your rock. Do whatever you want to do with it. I don't care. And at that point, the master probably comes and places the rock in your hand and says, here you go. You got it. You know, something like that. So, it's beyond simple. It's beyond simple. You don't have to be simple to the mind, because the functioning of reality is always exactly as it is. You don't establish it. You don't have to establish anything. None of us has to establish anything. None of us have to prove anything. None of us has to impress the mind with enlightenment. We're all trying to impress the mind. Say, mind, look how enlightened I am. Or if we're ready to choose another idea, mind will say, please, before you go, before you leave me, please, just show me how enlightened you are. I just want one glimpse of your great enlightenment, you know. And you say, oh, okay, mind. Now, don't say that. Say, I don't care, mind, what you say you want. I don't have any enlightenment to show you. I've got a new idea to show you. That's what you do. I don't have any enlightenment to show you. I've got a new idea to show you. Here you go. Very still here. Not a breath of air moving. High pressure system. Pushing the sea breeze off the coast. No inland flow. That'll happen Sunday. When the high pressure breaks down, the cold marine layer pushes back. You get the wind, you get a sudden drop of temperature. It'll drop 10, 15 degrees in a big hurry. So the heat waves don't last here very long, here in the Bay Area. A couple days. If the heat lasts like a week, that's a real heat wave here. This one is going to be 2 days, that's it. But I love it, it's wonderful. Love the heat waves. Very conducive to sitting still. When it's cold, you're trying to do something. I gotta put on some coats, I gotta stay warm, I gotta keep moving and all this stuff. When it's hot, you don't wanna move, you just wanna sit here. That's why I love the heat. You just wanna be still, very still. I remember the Japanese bass in Japan. Absolutely scaldingly hot. The only way to deal with it was to get in real quick, slip in real quick, and then not move for like 20 minutes. Don't even move a muscle. Don't even twitch. I mean, absolutely still. That traps a bubble layer around your body, and there's no motion of the water. That's what gives you the scalding feeling when you're moving. When you start moving, you feel absolutely scalded. If you sit and just remain absolutely still, you don't feel it. You hardly feel it. What happens is your heart rate starts going up. You start, you know, sweating. It's like amazing. But that's the secret to it. So hotness is conducive to remaining very still, whereas coldness is conducive to a lot of motion, a lot of action. Just sitting is very conducive to thinking, is very conducive to looking, is very conducive to inquiry, is very conducive to playing with ideas, concepts, looking at them. The activity becomes mental. It becomes attention to what's going on with mind and spirit. It becomes attention to that. That's the play that's going on. That's the activity. Whereas external activity, the body, is maybe no activity at all. Just sitting here like this. But the attention is active. It's looking at this, it's looking at that, saying, huh, a lot of activity going on that way. A lot of inquiry, a lot of looking. Whereas I tell you, if the body's really active and doing stuff for me, the inquiry goes, disappears, it's terrible. I've had no success with, like, some people say, well, if they're gardening, if they're doing stuff, no, for me, absolutely not. Actually, when I'm active, all sorts of hostile thoughts starts arising in me. Terrible thoughts, all this terrible, just hate it, just awful. Not good thoughts at all. Go off on tangents and daydreams and scenarios and scripts and everything. It's just, oh, terrible stuff. But where if I sit quiet and don't do anything, wonderful clarity comes. So, sometimes like repetitive actions, some of you just walking, but it's possible for me. No, sitting is what does it for me. Not in any particular posture. That becomes a performance or a practice. But just sitting comfortably. You can move by moving a little bit, but you can most of the time you just sit still. Not moving to get anywhere. If your leg's going to sleep, move. if there's an ache there, move. Just stay in a comfortable position and just look. And look at how wonderful this looking is. Is that grasshopper still here? Is it gone? I don't know. Oh, it's still there. It's still there. It's just walking around right now. Awesome. Yeah, the grasshopper's still there. I could probably get a picture of it. Oh well. Maybe it's trying to disturb our clarity. But actually it helped, didn't it? In fact, it provided a catalyst. Now to go back, to rewind on this video, I talk about how the subtlety of the Holy Spirit. So here we are talking, and suddenly this insect goes flying all over the place, and it's like, what the heck is that? And it lands, finally stops. And I was curious, like, what kind of insect is that? I don't know, it's a weird insect flying like that. And then I see this green grasshopper. And then suddenly that clicks in something about the Kung Fu series of grasshopper, and then the stone in the master's hand, and then suddenly I realize that the insight don't need to grab the stone from the master's hand. I never thought of that before. So that is the Holy Spirit in action right there. Perfect example of what we were talking about here. That's it. That sounds so clever, right? So creative, so beautifully creative. Holy Spirit sent a grasshopper in like this, at this very moment, to land there. And that then suddenly created a flood of insight that we don't have to impress the mind. This whole area of clarity. We don't need to answer the Zen koan. We don't need to come up with an answer. We don't need to be enlightened. We don't need to press the mind with enlightenment. All that stuff arose because that grasshopper flew in. Because I was ready, and the Holy Spirit sent a little aid in to trigger this. And of course people will say, ah, what nonsense. A grasshopper flying in. You think the Holy Spirit sent that? And they'll scoff. They'll scoff, 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 scoff. So it doesn't really help to tell people about it. They'll scoff, absolutely scoff, because it's different in everyone's case. It's a custom-made thing. That just happened to be what I needed to see to trigger this insight, which is a wonderful insights here. Tremendous, tremendous leap forward, like a quantum leap forward. All this while we've been trying to figure out how to snatch the stone from the master's hand, and suddenly we realize, why do I need to snatch the stone? I don't need to snatch the stone from anyone's hand. I don't care whose hand. It's not important. I don't have to do that. Finished. Finished with that, you see. That's it. I don't need to know how to do that. I don't need to know anything. I don't need to know anything. Right? Tell the mind, I don't need to know anything, mind. I'm in charge. I'm telling you, here's your new idea. I don't need to know anything. I already am what I am. Function, my functionality of reality always already is the functionality of reality. I don't need to know anything other than what is. What is doesn't need to be known. It already is. So, I don't need to know anything. And thanks to that grasshopper, which didn't come on its own accord, the Holy Spirit can use anything, anything and everything. Just a little, it's a hey. It just steers it in there, kind of like the grasshopper. Of course the grasshopper was coming in for the light. But why was there a grasshopper coming in for a light right at that moment, you see? The timing of it. The timing of it. Any other time, I would have missed it. You know, just that particular instant of coming in, it was the pregnant moment. It was the moment was ready for it. And the Holy Spirit did a little subtle thing right there. Greatness of the Holy Spirit. Does those kinds of things over and over and over and over and over, helping us out. Triggering insight. The key thing is we have to try. We have to make efforts. And then when we're ready, it'll be triggered somehow. So the Holy Spirit's the real guru. It's the real guru. We don't have to meet a guru. We already met the guru. We just met the guru. The grasshopper was the guru there? Is it still there? I don't know. Let me hit pause. I'm going to see if the guru is still there. Introduce you to the guru. Well, I'm not saying that the guru has left the building. That's how it goes too. It is somehow it has moved on. Maybe it's climbed up this area into the darkness. I can't find it, so that's okay. Don't have to. The guru's already done his business, and now it moves on. That too is the way the Holy Spirit will often do it. You know, it's just once it's been triggered, that's what's important. You don't need to thank the guru. You thank the Holy Spirit. Say, thank you, Holy Spirit. That's wonderful. Now, when you say, I don't need to snatch the stone from the hand, the mind will say, oh, you're so arrogant. And wow, you're an incredibly arrogant person. That's what I got when I was young. Everyone said, the mind told everybody to say, look at me and say, oh, that way, he's so arrogant. He thinks he doesn't need to learn anything. Utter arrogance. He thinks he doesn't need to learn how to snatch that stone from the master's hand. Yeah. Totally arrogant. That's what the mind was lying to everybody about that. Well, people believe in that lie. It's true. We don't need to snatch anything away from anything. We don't need to prove anything to the mind. The mind keeps insisting that if we'd say we don't need to prove anything to the mind, that we're arrogant. That's a lie. We are as God created us. That's not arrogance. It's arrogance to say that we can change what we are. That's where the arrogance is. That's where the spiritual pride and arrogance is. And so the mind's goal is to teach us how to be completely arrogant. So when someone comes here in the world and is not arrogant, the mind says, oh, there's the arrogance. It's projection. Of course, the mind projects its own arrogance and the arrogance of this idea to the one who's not arrogant says, oh, they're so arrogant. How terrible, how arrogant they are to think that they don't need to change, that they already have it. How is that possible? They don't impress me at all. Again, they're saying we don't need... They're saying that they don't need to impress the mind. Who are they to say they don't need to impress the mind? All this kind of stuff. You get all this kind of garbage, you know. It's just utter garbage. Just nothing but lies. But that makes it very tough here. If you buy into that, then you just get really crushed. No bugs flying around right now. That's what happens, right? So you say, oh, I don't want to be arrogant. I don't want people thinking I'm arrogant. Nobody's going to like me, you know, if I'm arrogant. Again, the mind will lie to it and lie and say, oh, you're arrogant, and you're not. Because you're saying, I cannot change what I am. So I'm prepping to accept that I cannot change what I am. That's not arrogance. That's humility. So the mind lies about arrogance and humility. It's got it backwards. It has it backwards. Lots of bugs. It's so hot. Heat it up quickly to this afternoon. Whoa, like that. Where I was working, it was over 100 degrees where I was working. I was working in this heat sink area. Oh man, it's like a blast furnace. Just sweat just pouring down. it can't last on that very long. So we're just getting used to this real humility, true humility, is to say, I don't need to prove anything to you, mind. That's humility, because it's saying, I am as God created me. I can't change what I am. So I don't need to impress you about my ability to change what is. And again, mind, you're the obedient servant. You don't need to be impressed. You function the way that God created you to function. I didn't create you, mind. So you're not my creation. So why do I have to impress you? You see, that's very important. We didn't create mind. So why do we need to impress mind? Is mind looking up to us and saying, oh, I need to feel impressed by you? No. God created mind. Mind simply is obedient servant that functions properly. So we don't have to have mind look up to us. As if it didn't look up to us, then it would refuse to function. That's nonsense. That's a total lie of mind, another lie. So you see how these lies are intimidating, thinking that you're arrogant if you call them, you know, if you tell the truth to them, you're arrogant, that's a lie. And so doing these videos is essentially standing up to the mind and saying, I don't have to prove anything to you, mind, not really. And fortunately, have not gotten too much pushback on it, on the videos. It's too late at this point anyway. It's too late. The game is up. The jig is up. The cat's out of the bag. But believe me, in my life, I have had an enormous amount of backlash and pushback by the mind, you know, making these lies, saying, "Oh, you're just arrogant. You're just selfish. You know, if you want to accept that reality as it is, the mind claims you're selfish. Oh, how selfish of you. You know, you're not helping change it, you know. You can't change it. Trying to help change it is just helping enmesh people in misery and suffering. That's a fact. And then people say, well, you're making me look bad. No, I'm not. You're making yourself look bad. I'm making you look good by showing you how to get free. I'm showing you how you can get free, so that makes you look good. I'm making anyone look bad. Everybody already looks bad. Not making them, just with the, you know, they can see, oh my gosh, maybe I'm listening to the lies of the mind. Well, that's good that you've seen that. They think, well, I've been stupid all this time. Well, it's good to see that. And you haven't been stupid. Is that the mind is completely brilliant, entirely brilliant in its presentation. So there's nothing you can do about that except give the mind a new idea. So he's not stupid. Spirit is neither smart nor stupid. But spirit can certainly entertain lies if it wants to. It can certainly believe in lies if it wants to. It's not stupidity. It's pride. It's just adventurousness. It's pride. It's adventurousness. It's whimsicality and stuff like that. It's not stupidity. So you say, well, I've been really dumb to listen to all these lies. No. Without the Holy Spirit, we would remain enthralled. So it's simply that our desire to experience is so strong that this entrapped us, as it were. And we wanted to believe. We wanted to believe this stuff. Because when you really see it, you say, how in the world can I ever believe that? Because we wanted to. But when we no longer want to believe something, it appears totally clear to us. We say, oh my gosh, how could I have ever believed that? Because we want it to. And when we want to believe something, when we give mind an idea as a present, the mind will make us believe it. We will absolutely believe it. It's that capable. And when we don't want to believe it, then we withdraw the idea from mind. We don't want you to lie to us anymore, mind. We want you to tell us the truth. Well, That can do it for now. Just a cool down period here. Just a cool down period. We're getting the flavor. We're getting the flavor here. Getting the flavor. Getting the feel like of a hot, hot day. Like getting the feel of that. Once you felt the heat, you're like, wow, okay. Like we went down to Palm Springs in the summer, one summer, and 18 degrees, or maybe 113, when I was playing golf in the shade. And got the feel of that. How can you get the feel of it if you don't do it? You can't. I had never been in that kind of heat in my life. I've always wanted to be in intense heat. I wanted to go to Death Valley or something. It was like 120 something. But I was afraid of that 120 Death Valley. But finally, it got to the Coachella Valley area, and it was 113. And that was amazing. That intense heat. It's a different feeling. It's a different feeling, really. I love it. I love it. It's so different. I don't know if I love to have it every day. I don't know. But so how do you get the flavor of real intensity of something that's really hot unless you actually go there, you know, experience it? Words, you can't explain to somebody, oh yeah, I went to Palm Springs and it was 113. They say, oh wow, that's really hot, huh? You don't know. And you don't know until you get out. And I got out into it. One day I was playing, I was golfing, and it got to me. And somebody came along and said, hey, this is what you do. And they said, get all the ice out, get the ice out of your ice chest, get a rag, get your towel, your golf towel to clean your clubs. Fill it up with ice, twist it up, fill it with ice. Put it under your hat, put your hat on, and do that. And I did that, and it started cooling my system down, because I was overheating. I was overheating. It was too much. And so I learned a lesson. I learned how to do that. that was incredible, that heat that day. Just roasting. It's just like, wow. Take like hardly breathe. Breathing in, it was hot just to breathe. But I was out there playing golf and enjoying it. Not a lot of people out there. That was really cool. I mean, I went out one day, and nobody out there, hardly, almost nobody on the course, except jackrabbits started emerging from there. Later in the day, the jackrabbits would emerge from their burrows, kind of come up, stretch. They stretch. Very cute, the long ears and everything, and they're getting ready for the evening to lope around and do what they do. But they stay underground during the day. They have their burrows go way down in the cool earth, and they just hang out there. Pretty amazing, huh? Pretty smart. That somehow they're able to dig to some place that, there's the cat showing up. See, the cat stays inside during the day when it's real hot because of the air conditioning. And then when it gets cooler outside, then it goes outside. It's very smart about that. But right now it's not so happy because it's hotter outside than it is inside right now. So it says, this isn't working out very well. All right, so again, we're transitioning back to the world at the end of the program here, because we were in this intense heat. I mean, this video, it was like just an intense hot Japanese bath. And you just say, oh my gosh, the mind is doing nothing but lying to me. It's all lies. And everything I try to do, it keeps misdirecting me and lying to me. And all this time I thought I needed to solve the koan, you know. I needed to get that stone. Now I realize I never needed to get it. I don't need to impress the mind. I don't need to be enlightened. I don't need to do anything at all. I don't need to know anything. Why do I need to impress the mind with knowledge? I don't need to know anything. I don't need to impress the mind. I don't need to do anything. I don't need to know anything. I don't need to solve anything. I just need to give the mind a different idea. So we'll just cool down a little bit from this. Cool down a little bit from this. And now you know the heat, the 113. 114. We were driving to along the road toward Las Vegas. We were going to visit a friend there, and it was in this intense heat wave, and Death Valley was in the 120 something. And where we were, it was the entrance to Death Valley, that area. And we got out of this air-conditioned car, and it was like 114 degrees right there. And it was kaboom. Going from like 68 degrees to 114 was that 46 degree difference or something. Just like immediate, you know, that kind of difference. Oh, there's the grasshopper. Let me see if I can get the grasshopper. There, it started flying. It flew up to this light. There's the grasshopper. Oh, it's going to the light now, you see? That's symbolic too. Oh, it's flying around up there. Where'd it go? I don't see it now, but it's up there. There it is, there it is, there it is, there it is. You see the grasshopper's telling us, go to the light. Go to the light. Go to the light. All right. Go to the light. Maybe it's not even a grasshopper. Let's go to the light. Remember to go to the light. The light of truth. That's it. Go to the light. Go to the light. Go to the light.